Emile Bouchard spoke about data handling. This is another example of practical use of data and conceptuality. Jan, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Jos. First of all, I want to thank the organization for inviting me to present the talk. And I think if I talk or I speak on behalf of all the Dutch delegates, we really love Dublin. It's a good place to be. Also want to thank Jos. A couple years ago, maybe many years ago, he rang me up and I was in practice, said, you want to do a PhD? So I started doing a PhD in Utrecht and then I moved to the Charles Sturt University in Wagga. And Wagga Wagga really exists. Look it up on a map, but it exists in Australia. And I came back a couple years later, about 2011, 12, and we thought, okay, what are we going to do next? So I came up with a couple of mates and said, look, what's the biggest frustration? Every time you talk to your mates or you go to a conference, you come back with lots of ideas. And everybody's got ideas. Probably when you go home, you've seen lots of talks and lots of ideas, but what are you going to do with next week or the week after? So we decided actually to split our practice into a normal regular dairy practice, and another part is just an extension service. And what we do actually, we make concepts, that's why the name is Cowcept. We make concepts for farmers, for veterinarians, actually to deal with all those questions, all these ideas. And one of the biggest ideas we had was actually to develop a data collection tool for transition cows, but also for other groups of cows in your herd. And I must say the biggest credit is for the first author, Gert-Jan Hofstee. He actually developed the whole program. He did a lot of software development for that, but I was just unlucky drawing the shortest straw last night, so I have to do the presentation. But anyway, it's a good tool. We actually are selling into different practices now, and I will tell you something about the tool itself. I was just wondering, there's not much information or not a lot of discussion, I think, about this. The milk quota disappeared last year, especially from all the vets from Europe. That has a massive impact on us. It has on the farm as well. We also talked about, okay, we got larger herd sizes, but is it really happening? And finally it is. And this little map here from Holland. There's a little graph here which is very small, and okay, every year we got a couple more cows in the herd. Well, actually what's happening is a lot of big herds. So the average herd's maybe 85, 86, but it doesn't tell the story. Like up north, a lot of farms actually going above 200, 250 head per farm. And some of you may say, okay, that's a very small farm. My area's got farms of 4,000, 6,000 cows. Other areas probably only 50 cows. But for us, it's a substantial change. The other thing is those farmers actually going to work with a lot of hired labor. So that's different for them as well. And they move away from a traditional farm into a more process control. So in the old days, or the old days, you say, okay, I've got a cow, I'm going to inseminate her, she's going to be pregnant or she's not pregnant. She's going to do it again. Now it's more about, it's a production system. We need so much milk a year, so we have to inseminate so many cows per month. So it's a whole different approach now for farmers as well. And the last thing, actually, they're changing the whole thing about, they have to work with different people. So becoming from a normal farmer, they have to be a people manager now as well. Other things would change for us. Over the last couple of years, because the quota disappeared, we had different legislation. There's a lot of things happening at the moment as well. One of the things, actually, there's a huge reduction in the use of antibiotics on our dairy farms. I think over the last couple of years, it's almost halved it. So the last 5 years, we're only using half the antibiotic we used before. Is that a downside? I don't know. We're going to talk about it later. The other thing is we always talked about, okay, we want to move away from being a fire brigade and do more preventive medicine. I think that's happening at the moment, finally. Because we do use less antibiotics. We have to be more proactive. There's larger farms we have to deal with. So the number of curative visits actually declined. We looked at several practices, and we looked at how many times do farmers call you out for a sick cow. And you know what? The small farms with 80, 90, 100 cows, they call quite regularly. But the guys up with 200, 300, 400 cows, they either treat themselves or they cull their cows. So you're not called out as many times as on a small farm. So it's moving away from this curative farm visits and more into the preventive, the herd health, as you like. The other things last couple of years, and maybe it's the same in your area, we got lots of competitors coming into the market for reproduction services. They can either do it via milk or they send out technicians. And actually, that was still like our little area. We got access to the farms because we're doing the reproduction work. But now we've got lots of competition in that area and that market as well. So we have to be very proactive to actually make sure we actually are still getting to that farm. And I talk to lots of different practices, and we talk about marketing. And marketing especially is something we're not good at. all our competitors have a huge team of marketeers that work on the farms. They actually make cohorts of farmers they're going to approach or not. So we started doing that as well in our farms, making different cohorts of farmers. We're going to advise to do such a service to this cohort, or we're going to do a workshop for that cohort, because otherwise it probably won't work. So is that a disadvantage or advantage, all these changes for us? I think it's all an advantage, especially the first one, because we're not allowed to use that antibiotic anymore. We have to deal with more prevention, more vaccination, more selling our knowledge. Finally, we're getting away from that fire truck, going to more preventive medicine. We have to need the discussion about working within certain standards. Otherwise, we can't reduce this use of antibiotics by almost half in 5 years' time. So that's a good thing, I think. So moving away from the fire brigade, that's another thing we really desperately want to get out of. Not because it's a huge income source, but it's also very unpredictable. Because in springtime, it's very busy. In summertime, everybody doesn't know what to do in the afternoons. Like if you go into more your preventive health management, you can actually plan your visit a year ahead. So away from this curative visits, the many competitors for your reproduction, I think that's a good thing as well. Finally, we have to stretch ourselves and say, okay, what are we going to do? What's going to be our goal? What's going to be our like additional value for that farm instead of just palpating cows? And we always tell, okay, because we do the palpation, we actually have a better way of doing it, or we can scan cows much better. I'm not sure. I'm not convinced if that's the case. So we're trying to get a more holistic approach. Look, our goal is still being a veterinarian, and veterinarians have to deal with herd health, but also sick cows, and also have to deal with the whole physiology of a cow. So most of our competitors just come for that one, like either AI service or fact check or that kind of thing. So they all pick little bits and pieces. What we can do, we can actually have the whole lot. We can do everything, from young stock to lameness to mastitis to reproduction. Sometimes we try and forget that. Sometimes we're very, very angry at ourselves because a farmer's walking away because he's going to do his reproduction somewhere else, and we think we're going to lose all the work on that particular farm. Well, that's not the case. As long as you offer your complete service, not just one item. And that proactive, that's another thing. I think it's very good as a farmer or as a veterinarian to look at your clients and say, okay, what kind of clients do you have? In the old days, we send out a newsletter and say, okay, we're going to do a workshop on lameness. But there's always this 10 same farmers coming up and say, okay, we're going to do this workshop. And so now we've got to actually actively promote and trying to get these farms in. So the other thing is farmers want to be in control. So sometimes people say, I feel myself more like a salesman instead of being a veterinarian. I don't think that's the case. Look, our answer is developing a tool. That's what we're going to talk today. The Coors tool is really about, okay, how are we going to manage those farms? How are we going to actually make sure our knowledge is transferred to a farmer, and actually it's got to be simple. We're going to make some money out of it, and the farmer has to see the benefits of it. So getting away from everything we can't see. Get away all the subclinical. We talked about subclinical mastitis, subclinical metritis. That's what we're going to get rid of. So we developed this tool, Coors. It's a Dutch word. I think it's translated, it's like direction, which direction you're going with your cows. It's an online software tool, so you can enter the data, but the farmer can do it as well. You can do it on your iPad behind the cows. It's accessible for farmers and for the veterinarians themselves. It's a scoring method. You can assess cows at the same time. It's about animal health and reproduction, and actually you're going to look at individual cows, but also you want to do assessment on herd level, because you can't forget like to assess your individual cows, what's going on, to say something about herd level. If you look at ketosis, there's a certain percentage of cows with ketosis. That's going to be, you have to treat as individual cows, but you also want to know how many cows you got on the farm itself. So, very simple, we're all familiar with. If you got the reproduction cycle of a cow, you start off with her calving down, you got your fresh cow group, then you move into, she's going to be ready to be bred again. Finally, she gets inseminated. She's moving up to a dry cow period. You have one or two different fire off of closing up groups, and then she's moving back into the pen of getting, being a fresh cow again. So the simple thing we just did is just, okay, every period, got this little controls, how do you want to call it, control process tools or PPIs, or there's all kind of words for. What it means is just, what's the thing you can monitor on these groups of cows, and what's be simple, what can be done on the farm, on the cow, and be like the data collected straight away onto your iPad and selected your analysis if you like. So types of assessment we do, especially for the fresh cow groups, is like ketosis, is doing palpation to see like if the manure score, but also do like if there's final discharge, condition score, ovaries, all kind of things you can do in one cow. And it takes about a minute a cow. And what we do it every week. The old farm visits, we came every 4 or 6 weeks. What we found out quite rapidly is that if you do it today and you miss a cow, it's calving down tomorrow, and you're only coming down in 6 weeks again, you're going to miss the cow for 6 weeks. So the thing is with this assessment tool, we come every week and we take all the fresh cows and all the cows, whatever the farmer wants. Like we can have the drive group, or you can have the cows that have just been bred. So the farmer decides what he wants to do. That's the beauty about this online tool. There are different groups. First of all, the first time he's going to decide which group he wants to do. Either it's just reproduction, or he wants to do his young stock, or he wants to do fresh cows. He can decide. He can make it very simple, or he can make it very as broad and large as he wants to. The other thing is, like, there's a threshold per farm. It's not a fixed one. He can say, okay, I want to start inseminating in 60 days or 70 days or 50 days. So that's the first time you just enter these data with the farmer. And the third box here is about which kind of data he wants to collect. Just condition score or tepal test or somatic cell count or anything like he's just interested in. So it's a very flexible system for the farmer. He's going to decide what kind of management, what kind of control, what kind of assessment he wants to do on his farm. Yep. So it's a weekly program. Every week there's a list coming out. And the list is actually going to tell you what you're going to do, what kind of monitoring you want to do on that farm and that cow. And the beauty is you have a real-time assessment afterwards. So when you enter the data, you can push the button and straight away you're going to see, okay, this is actually how it's going. How many ketoses? Is ketosis related to the intercalving period? So it's a real-time assessment on the farm. So we had 13 farms entered into the system. We looked at 12 months before the system started and 12 months after the system implemented. And we looked, okay, what's going to make the difference for the farmer? So the results were we had, like, on those farms, actually, the herd size didn't decrease. The use of antibiotics, that's a new measurement in our country, we're going to use the daily dosage. That's halved. So those farms actually use half the antibiotics they did before. The intercalving period actually decreased by almost 14 days. Numbers of inseminations per cow or per calf decreased from 2.2 to 1.9. The bulk somatic cell count actually didn't change. That's not that weird because it's an average of the herd, but anyway. The clinical mastitis actually decreased as well. So overall, the system did work. And what we concluded from the whole, using this tool for a couple of years now, the first 2 years, that farmers really appreciated the standard approach. So you come to the farm, they know exactly what's going to happen. You're going to have these kind of groups of cows. You're going to monitor regularly at base, and you're going to do your assessments straight away. Farmers appreciated early detection and early treatment. So every week we go on the farm, you detect cows very early, and after that, you're going to treat them straight away. So on the other hand, as a downside, it's a significant time investment in when you start this. So you have to get the data in. You have to farm it, to train them, actually, to select the proper cows. It's quite an investment for him the first couple of months to actually get used to a vet coming in each week. They're not used to that. Normally, it was a 4 or 6 week interval. Data analysis, that's the other thing. Okay, we're going to do an assessment now, but what's the follow-up? You have to be very critical on that. But the main 2 points for us is actually we're going to focus on the process. You want to have so many cows in calf by the end of the year, okay, this is what we're going to have to do. This is how we monitor our cows. So not on an ad hoc approach anymore. So a very strict protocol. That's going to be very helpful for us as well, because now we can plan actually all our farm visits the next 12, 16 months in ahead. So for us, it's actually a system very well to actually implement on farms, and we actually have the benefits for the farm as well as this real-time assessment, and he actually can drive the whole program himself. That was my conclusion, and I'm hopefully just in time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Jan, for this other approach of data handling. Questions? I got the idea this is in a testing phase, now finished.
Yep. Yep. We.
You're spreading to a larger group.
Yeah, there are multiple veterinary clinicians now who are going to work with it, so, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, finally.
No questions? Okay, thank you again, Jan, for your presentation.
Thank you.